Hi, Ross and Kathy Callaghan here again, and we're off on another cruise. And this time we're on the Grand Princess. We're going from Melbourne up to Sydney, and then from Sydney across the Tasman to New Zealand, which is our home country. We've been looking forward to this very much.
Yes, because it's been 3 years since we've been cruising, so it'll be interesting to see what measures have been taking place in that time.
To sort it out so that we can travel safely because of COVID. Should be good.
So we're in stateroom C631. This is on deck 10, so fairly high up in the ship. Now we have a basic room, not unlike most other cruise ships that we've been on. Always has a desk, very comfortable beds. They did a big refurbishment in 2019 and they now have quite a number of these USB ports, and you need those actually because everything is so electronic, so you need your devices, and that is a really good feature that they have. What they have available for putting your clothes and things away is fairly Spartan, I think, compared to other cruise ships. The wardrobe in there is quite small, just two sides, but it works for us. And this is the bathroom, which is just normal, what you get on a ship. Very clean. So this stateroom is a balcony stateroom, so we can go out here on nice days. We can sit out here, have a coffee, or just enjoy the sunshine. It's raining right now, so it's not exactly what you'd be wanting to do right now, but it's fresh air.
We're interested in how cruising has changed after the COVID epidemic. So we're going to comment on that throughout this video. It started for us with the embarkation and check-in process. We had to do most of our paperwork online. So when we turned up, we were given our medallion and it was a breeze. Once we got our medallion, we'd proven that we didn't have COVID and we were on board in a flash and straight to our cabin. Then when we got to our cabin, mysteriously, the door unlocked as we approached. That was courtesy of this thing. And we were in. It was just so smooth and effortless. And so I think that's a great, great way that Princess have improved the process of getting us all on board. And then for the cruise experience, the medallion is linked to an app. Now, I know lots of people have had trouble with the app, but we find the app very, very good. And the medallion, the app, are linked to the TV. And so you always know what's going on. You can plan, you can buy things, you can sort out your day. And I find that the electronics that are going on board nowadays, really, really good. Lots of things are going on around the Grand Princess all the time. So we thought we'd show you some of these wonderful things that are taking place. We'll show you some of the food that we're eating. We'll show you some of the beautiful music, just little snippets to give you a taster of what it's like, and some of the activities that we've been involved in. It sure is fun on this ship. Let's start with the food. There are lots of specialty restaurants on this ship, but there are also lots of places where you can get lovely food where it's all included and you don't have to pay extra. So we'll give you a quick look at all the places where you can get food that's included in your fare, and the food is pretty good. This is the buffet on the Grand Princess. Lots of lovely food for breakfast, lunch and dinner. What do you think of the food?
Oh, they do a great job setting things out easily for you, and some of it is absolutely delicious.
Look at this, bacon and eggs for breakfast. I only ever get that on cruise ships. So thank you, Grand Princess.
And I've got waffles. Don't get that at home either for breakfast.
The buffet's full of all sorts of goodies. Some of them are good for you, and some of them aren't. But they're all lovely. Salads galore. Meats. And the breads are just fantastic. And just look at the beautiful desserts. Oh, wow. If you go hungry on this ship, there's something wrong with you. On the Grand Princess, there are three main restaurants, and they all offer beautiful food. They all offer the same menu, a la carte menu. Very nice. There's Botticelli's, there's Da Vinci's, and there's Michelangelo's. And the wait staff in each of them are just so helpful.
Tonight we're having a seafood terrine, chorizo croquettes, potato soup, and a very nice salmon.
Or you could have something like this, lentils, eggs, and sweet potatoes. Pan-fried snapper, that does look nice. Or how about some tender pork belly, or lobster tails, and crab cakes. And then look at the desserts. Here we've got a build your own sundae. And this is the love boat special.
I think it's more a dream boat special actually. Yeah. They go the extra mile when it comes to dessert. Beautiful.
Been around the pool. You can get a pizza or a pretty hot stuffed burger. Look at that. It's been a few years now since we've cruised with Princess, and there have been changes with respect to their food and dining. Health and safety is very much to the forefront, and you have to wash your hands before you eat, and the tables are spread further apart, and they're certainly very careful to make sure that there's no spread of disease. I think they've also done a lot of work in terms of wastage, so that there isn't so many options as before, and perhaps the food isn't quite as grand as it was before, but it's still very, very good. So well done, Princess. You've given us great food, and you've done it in a way that is safe and also without too much waste. Brilliant. One of the joys of cruising is eating all the time. But eating all the time doesn't make you feel so good because you get so bloated, or I do anyway. So what we do is we make sure we do lots and lots of exercise. Walking around the decks like this, going to the gym, taking the stairs, anything to use up some energy so we can eat some more of that good food.
Stairs are our friends.
Yeah, sometimes.
The ship's going up and down. Whoops. Sometimes you have the impression that you could be a little bit inebriated.
Oh, we're really in the bowels of the ship here. So it's about 900 steps to go right round deck 7. Means I can have some pizza for lunch.
Very nice. I earned you.
In previous cruises, we would do all the steps, but it's been 3 years, a lot's changed in 3 years. We're older, so we're friends with the lift as well this time.
For the music and various activities that are going on, you can book them if necessary through your medallion. find out about them from a daily newsletter or from the big TVs that are all around the ship or from the TV in your cabin or from the app on your phone. And so there's lots of ways you can find out what's happening and also book what's happening. So here's some of the lovely music and some of the activities. I fell into a burning ring of fire. I went down, 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 and the flames went high. It burns, burns, burns. The ring of fire, the ring of fire.
Maori culture, so there's plenty of things to be excited about.
This is when we have 13,000 back to you at 13,100 for a unique one of a kind from one of the leading artists, Romero Brito.
Then they hung out, but you can hold around free.
Oh, who would be?
Yes, yes, any of the Romero fans.
Up we have I-22. Two little duckies. If you got this one, give me a quack, quack. Quack, quack. Bang, bang.
Bang, bang.
Yum, yum.
Yum, yum.
Crispy duck.
Oh, brilliant.
So it's all strategy. I don't have to do anything. So I'll just give it a little quack.
wash, and if he stays minus 20, he loses.
I thought she mightn't have noticed that. Oh! Nothing to you. Nothing wins.
I still win.
Our first port stop is in the little township of Eden, which is about halfway between Melbourne and Sydney. Eden has a population of about 3,000. They love it when the cruise ships come in. We're going to walk up the hill over there into the main little township. Eden certainly is a quaint little town. And having us here has boosted the economy terrifically. Bring out all their little markets and all the people come and welcome us.
Eden's very much a whaling town. And in the old days, the baleen whales used to come in close off the shore here. And the story goes that an orca whale used to help the whalers by herding them into shore. That orca whale was known as Old Tom, and all he wanted was the tongue and the lips after they had been harvested. So that story of Old Tom is celebrated here in the Whaling Museum.
The killer whales were pretty incredible. They used to herd the big whales into this cove here and take them down to where the whalers used to live. And once they had them caught, they used to go in and wake up the whalers and bring the whalers back out to their catch. As long as the killer whales got the prime meat, they were happy. But it meant that there was, over a period of about 50 years, there was a partnership between the whalers and the killer whales. And if a whaling ship went down, the killer whales used to go and protect and care for the whalers who were still in the sea. Pretty incredible story, eh?
Back in the day, if you suffered from rheumatism, they'd take you to a dead whale, make a hole, and you'd go down and sit in it for an hour and a half, and apparently that cured your rheumatism.
There's a very high concentration of krill here in Twofold Bay, which is why the whales stop off here as they're migrating towards Antarctica.
So the locals are very proud of a series of mosaics that are here, just telling the story of the whalers. Here we have Old Tom herding in the smaller whales.
So we say farewell to Eden. I must say it's been really lovely visiting and learning about the whaling history. Next stop is Sydney. Well, we made it to Sydney and there she is, the Sydney Harbour Bridge. We thought we'd climb up there and then give you a quick look at the main sights of this incredible city. So, welcome to Sydney, Australia. So here's the wonderful Sydney Harbour, the Opera House, Circular Quay, the ferries there, Grand Princess, and downtown Sydney. Pretty fantastic sight, isn't it? Down there's the rocks. And the ship certainly does make a statement on the downtown area, doesn't it? Sydney really is a happening place. Fantastic. So we say farewell to Sydney, just as the sun sets. We've now got 3 days at sea going across the Tasman before we reach the South Island of New Zealand at our first stop, which is Picton.
So we made it to New Zealand through Queen Charlotte Sound. It's just beautiful. There's the Inter-Islander coming over from Wellington.
And here's the beautiful foreshore of the little town of Picton. There we have the Inter-Islander and the Edwin Fox. Edwin Fox, the 9th oldest ship in the world, the oldest merchant ship that's still surviving, brought immigrants to New Zealand. You can take the Marlborough Flyer and have a look at the Marlborough Sounds and its vineyards and beautiful scenery. The easiest way to get around the Marlborough Sounds is by boat, and some pretty nice little boats down there, isn't there? There's the township of Picton.
So Picton is primarily here because of the Inter-Islander. That's the ferry between the North and the South Island. But when a cruise ship comes in, they really put it all on. They put on music, they put on stalls, and they put on a beautiful day.
We always love visiting Picton. Such a lovely little town, and especially on a gorgeous day like today. Isn't it fabulous? Marlborough around Picton is very much wine country, and these are Sauvignon Blanc. These ones are Pinot Noir. Lots of sugar in them, very sweet. And these ones are Chardonnay, so I'll taste one. It's due to be harvested next week.
But you'll find it pretty sharp.
Not full of sugar, that one.
That's because it's going to bubbles.
So we say farewell to Picton. Had a lovely day. Now we're heading for Wellington, up the beautiful Marlborough Sounds. And now welcome to Wellington. And Wellington's where we come from. It's a little bit strange to be on a cruise ship and coming home, but it's a wonderful city. They reckon that Wellington is the coolest little capital in the world. Capital of New Zealand.
We've lived in and around Wellington for over 30 years and we love this place, and it's great to be able to show people just how beautiful it is.
Wellington's the capital of New Zealand, and these are our Parliament buildings. On the left is the Beehive, which is parliamentary offices. And Parliament itself sits in this old building. And here we have Te Papa, the National Museum. Wonderful museum of New Zealand, and you can certainly spend a day easily in there. And the famous cable car takes you from the Botanic Gardens down to the Wellington City Centre. And this is Oriental Parade. Beautiful beaches. You can't beat Wellington on a good day. The waterfront in Wellington is just fantastic. There's people everywhere and so much to see and do, and it just hums with activity. Fantastic place to be. Lots of lovely cafes in the waterfront and throughout Wellington. It's very much a cafe city. It's a little bit funny coming to Wellington as a tourist when we've lived here for such a long time. But it just reinforces that Wellington's a fantastic place, a wonderful city. So kia ora,
Thank you, Wellington. Thank you for letting us live here. And thank you for letting us be a tourist here as well.
And now we're in the Hawke's Bay. And we're in the city of Napier. And Napier's been ravaged recently in the cyclone, so it's good that we're here. Can sort of help the economy a little bit.
February the 2nd, 1931, there was a massive earthquake here in Napier. The whole city got flattened. So they decided to rebuild it with an Art Deco theme. And that's what distinguishes Napier today. And every year in February, they have an Art Deco festival here in Napier. Everybody dresses up in 1930s gear. There's incredible singing and dancing. The vintage cars are out. Everybody's dressed up and it's a real celebration. Over 40,000 people come here to Napier at that time to enjoy the Art Deco festival.
Classical Art Deco building over there. And over there. And all the way down the main street as well. What do you think of Art Deco, you and your friend?
Me and my flapper friend. It's pretty cool.
Napier's not just about Art Deco. It's beautiful beaches. They're stony beaches. Fantastic cycleways. There's an aquarium here. It's a lovely Hawke's Bay city. The best place to get a view of the Hawke's Bay is from the top of Te Mata Peak, way up there. It's not often you get such a clear day to see this view. Way over there in the distance is Napier. Then down here in front of us is Hastings. And the main mountains that go right through New Zealand in the distance. And then looking to the south. How special to be here. And this guy's just climbed all that way up Mount Te Mata Peak. And Hawke's Bay is also known for its wines. That's Craggy Range Winery down there. Make beautiful wines. Napier changes a lot when the tourist ships are in. Lots and lots of people here enjoying the Art Deco. But there is a Starbucks and a McDonald's, of course. So we've had a really lovely day here in Napier, the Art Deco capital of New Zealand. And Napier certainly has turned it on for us. Yet another lovely New Zealand city.
Our next port stop was supposed to be Tauranga, but unfortunately an approaching storm meant we've had to miss it. So we thought we'll show you a few shots from a previous cruise so you don't miss out on seeing what a visit to Tauranga is like.
And now welcome to the fabulous Bay of Plenty, named by Captain Cook. Over there is the city of Tauranga, the main city in the Bay of Plenty. And it's one of New Zealand's most popular and fast-growing cities. About an hour away from Tauranga here is Rotorua, well known for its thermal activity and its Maori culture. And close by is Hobbiton, well known to Hobbit fans. The whole area of the Bay of Plenty is well known for its farms and produce, and especially for growing of kiwi fruit. A fabulous place to live. And over here is Mount Maunganui, and that's one of New Zealand's most popular beach resorts. And here's Mount Maunganui's ocean beach. Just great for surfing. Beautiful white sands. They call this place the Mount. And at certain times of the year, like New Year's Eve, there's thousands and thousands of people here. One of New Zealand's hottest spots.
Just gorgeous here.
Not bad, eh? This Bay of Plenty sure is a lovely place to visit. And it's great that we can do it from a cruise ship. We've been here lots of times before, but it's nice to be coming here as a tourist.
Well, we made it to our final port stop, which is Auckland. There's the city way over there and Rangitoto. We're going to stay right where we are, out at sea, until tomorrow morning when we are going to be able to go in and berth. So we say, welcome to Auckland. Beautiful.
Our 11 days on the Grand Princess are over, and it's been a fantastic cruise. We had two purposes in this cruise. One was to find a different way to get home, perhaps more relaxing than flying, and it's certainly done that. It's been wonderful. The second is to see how cruising has changed since COVID. This is our first cruise post-COVID, and it has proved to be very safe, and we have felt safe. The best thing is the electronic system that they have on Grand Princess, because there's no more of that tedious mustering stuff. It's all done electronically and before we even got on the ship. Also, I can track Ross down anywhere on the ship that he is. I just go into my little app and it tells me where he is and how to get there, so that's a good thing too. The ports of call are always amazing, of course, because we love New Zealand, and it's always wonderful to pop in and reacquaint ourselves with these beautiful places. So, thank you, Princess. A very nice cruise.
Yes, what this cruise has done has given me confidence that we can go cruising and that it will be safe. I think Princess have done a very, very good job at that. Maybe they've pared things back a wee bit to make sure that things are safe, but I think the whole cruising experience has been very similar to previously, but in a slightly pared back way, so that I always have felt safe. So it has been a lovely, lovely time visiting these ports of call and getting back into cruising. Thank you, Princess. Thank you, Grand Princess. We sure have had a wonderful time.